Now joining us this morning is the Metro Manila Development Authority's Traffic Chief for EDSA, Mr. Edison Bong Nebrija. Good morning, sir, and thank you very much for joining us again, sir.
Good morning, Christian, and good morning to all your viewers.
Okay, let's talk about day one of the general community quarantine in Metro Manila, specifically EDSA, the avenue under your jurisdiction. What was the volume of vehicles that you were able to monitor yesterday on day one of the GCQ?
We are looking at around 50 to 60% volume on EDSA. That is compared to the volume that we had prior COVID. And, you could see buildups already on some points of EDSA. And that's an indication that really, vehicles are back here. And many people are already using EDSA for their daily commute to work and going back home.
And were you able to identify the reasons behind certain traffic buildup in certain parts of EDSA? Which particular parts in the first place were prone to traffic congestion?
Well, basically, Christian, we can attribute that to, confusion for one. Many of our motorists still do not know that the left lane, that EDSA has already been reconfigured and the bus lane is now on the left side or the region lane. And we have barricaded this. We have put up concrete barriers, plastic barriers, and cones so that to indicate that this is a bus exclusive lane for buses. And apparently, many motorists did not get the memo and still, drive their way on the median lane. So that's why delaying the traffic, because at the entry points, they're being drive away from the inner lane to the outer lanes. So again, this yesterday was the first day. Many of the people didn't go out during the ECQ and MECQ, and they were just surprised that EDSA has already changed. And most of the choke points that we have identified are those going down the underpasses and going up the flyovers, primarily because that private motors are used to using that, and they. Even though that the yellow lane before, the two lanes near the curbside, are already free of buses, still private motorists do not want to use it, and they still try to squeeze their way in to the bus lane on the left and the two remaining lanes going down the underpass and going up the flyover.
So there was still a confusion when it came to which particular lanes were supposed to be used by private vehicles and those that were supposed to be used by the buses, but I'm curious about the 50 to 60% volume that you monitored yesterday. Despite that reduced volume, you still experience a heavy traffic along EDSA. Mr. Nebrija? Hello, sir.
Yes, sir. Buildups, but yeah. There were buildups yesterday, but this was different from the one that we had prior COVID. Because, yes, you could see the buildup, the volume of vehicles, but the traffic is fairly moving. Mm-hmm. So there were slowdowns in some parts, but I must say it was still fairly good compared to the traffic that we had prior COVID.
Okay. Now let's talk about the numbers that you crunched. Basically, you did the math, I suppose, when it came to the projected number of private vehicles that would use EDSA during the GCQ and the number of the modes of public transportation that would be made available. Because yesterday we saw a lot of problems, not just along EDSA, but also in other areas around Metro Manila, wherein you had so many commuters, but there was not enough public transportation available.
Understandably, Christian, because we are just pacing in the public transport. We just do not want to pace all the transportation all at once because, there's still the pandemic here and we're trying to see the response of the commuters pace by pace. Yesterday, we saw that there were less commuters and now the OTR paced in another two routes, one coming from Angat to Commonwealth and one from the Marinas Cavite to Baclaran. So that is additional routes. And then maybe in the days to come, there will be more routes that will be phased in until such time that all these arterial routes going to EDSA will be connected already and we will be seeing more commuters using the MRT and the bus augmentations. And eventually, on June 22, the city buses. This, we need to do this just to protect the commuters as well, because we do not want them to trap in one station of MRT and or other bus stops. And then, you know, everybody will just get the virus and transmit it back home.
Yeah.
So we're just protecting.
But how do you actually monitor, for example, private commuters, the private motorists who are using EDSA, for example, on whether they are supposed to be outside or not? Because there are still restrictions despite the GCQ scenario.
That's right, Christian. Well, we do not want to add up to the problem of EDSA anymore. And putting up a checkpoint here right now will be catastrophic, and we will be delaying a lot of people, even the frontliners and emergency responders. So HPG yesterday, what they did is they made a modified checkpoint. You know, they have motorcycle riders, and they will just breeze through traffic and see, you know, randomly check on vehicles. They pull over random vehicles, and they check if they're upper or upper. And besides, Christian, GCQ, there are more people who are authorized to be outside the residence as compared when we were in ECQ and MECQ.
Yeah, because another concern, I'm sure you're monitoring this also, that this particular scenario can be seen also as anti-poor or against those who do not have access to private vehicles because they don't have enough public transportation available to them. Meaning the workers, for example, who are definitely allowed to return to work under GCQ.
Well, it's always been like that. Every government policy are being criticized as anti-poor.
Mr. Nebrija?
But no, this was that. I'm sorry, Christian. There's somebody calling me. What we wanted to happen is that just to phase in a phase that we could accommodate, right? Because it's hard. It's hard that we cramp all these people with limited capacity in public transport. So, but again, like what I said, the OTR added two more routes today.
Okay.
And then maybe tomorrow or the succeeding days, there will be more. So we just want to phase in one by one.
Okay, so gradual easing in.
Yes.
Into the general community,
right?
Quarantine. But talk to us about the wisdom behind the four bus stops identified on EDSA. North Avenue, Quezon Avenue, Ayala Avenue, and Taft Avenue. Because if you look at the comments coming from regular commuters, some of them are criticizing the government, saying that this was a plan that was prepared by someone who was not actually a commuter.
Well, Christian, here's the thing. In the phase one of the public transport, phasing in of public transport on EDSA, or Metro Manila, I mean, it is only the trains, right, that are allowed. MRT, LRT1, LRT2, plus ANBS taxis, right? So the buses that you saw yesterday, these are MRT bus augmentations. These are not the city buses that we're trying to fix in. The city buses will come in on June 22. These are just bus augmentations for the MRT. Why is that? Because with the reduced capacity of MRT, for example, MRT3 to 13%, we anticipated that there will be a lot of displaced commuters. So to augment that, we put up buses there. And the reason why it's only Ayala and Taft Avenue, because those are the two endpoints of the MRT line. So it's we want the commuters to breeze through. It's like an express lane. So that's what we did. And again, as I've told you, later on when we phase in the city buses, there will be more bus stops for the commuters to load and unload.
But how about commuters who are supposed to go to places in between those four bus stops along EDSA? For example, somewhere between North Avenue and let's say Quezon Avenue, for example. So what's the plan regarding their access and how they're supposed to get to their destination in between?
Are we talking about workers here?
For example, workers who are not provided, for example, shuttle vans or buses by their own companies, ordinary
that's
workers.
Right. Mm. Yes, that's right. That's why even before, we already told the company owners to please provide shuttles for them. And if you cannot provide, let them work from home or provide an accommodation for them. Really, we're just trying to phase in the transportation. And I hope the public will understand that this is not final yet. This is just the beginning. And in the days to come, the OTR has a plan to phase in more routes. So we do not want to overwhelm the system in a way that there will be more commuters and there will be less buses and there will be chaos on the road because everybody's confused. So that's why we're just trying to phase in one by one so that commuters will get used to it slowly but surely.
Okay, now I understand also that on phase two, you'll be allowing public utility buses somewhere around 300 to 500. But how will you choose which particular buses would be allowed to operate during phase two of the GCQ?
It will be the discretion of the LTFRB. I think they have a guidelines for that. They will be the one to identify which bus will, what bus will take certain routes. And long before, even before COVID, we're talking about consortium already, so that this will be given to certain groups of bus companies to ply certain routes. So this is not like before that so many bus companies in so many routes, right? So this is the plan, and I think it's a sound plan. Let's give it a chance to work while we are pacing in one by one the 31 nationalized routes that were identified by DOTR.
Okay, but we can only imagine how problematic the situation might be, because you have thousands of bus units and then you'll be allowing a very small number compared to the actual number of buses available along EDSA. So
Christian, we're barricading the bus lane.
Okay.
And we're operating 600 buses with minimum stops of 15. So it's not unlike before that we have stoplights, we have so many bus stops and even other unauthorized loading and unloading zones on EDSA. So now you cannot just say para, or you can just flag down a bus and then ride. No, you need to go to a bus stop and you need to wait there. And besides, no vehicles will be able to get through the bus lanes anymore, like the motorcycles and private vehicles that delays the traffic, the flow of traffic for the bus lanes. So now this is barricaded and the bus will just go round and round. Right, and you know the attitude of drivers when it comes to stoplight, it's a go that they will slow down because they want to stop right at the intersection, delaying everybody behind them. Mm. So now you cannot do that anymore because there are no more stoplights. There's no reason for you to stop except for the bus stops.
Okay, but when are you going to complete, for example, the bus lanes, for example, and then the crossing area for those who would be taking the bus, because they would need to cross to the other side of EDSA, right?
Yes. Well, it's still the construction is going on, right? And this will be ready by June 22, if I'm not mistaken, because that's the target date that the city bus, the single bus route on EDSA will be operating. So DPWH is working around the clock to finish all these requirements for the bus stops, for the footbridges and MRT station.
Okay, finally, given yesterday's experience, are you looking at particular adjustments, let's say, this week to help improve the situation on EDSA during the early part of the GCQ?
Well, this is a continuous assessment. So whatever adjustments that we need to make, this will be brought up to the OTR, LTFRB, and other government agencies involved in transport and traffic management. I already submitted my first day assessment to the OTR yesterday so that they could come up with contingencies for that matter. And yes, as I told in my previous interviews, this is all new for all of us. And there will be adjustments, there will be birth pains, but let's give it a chance to work. I know first day was...
Mr. Nebrija?
So confusing, okay. But later on, but yes.
Okay.
So yesterday was a little bit confusing, but later on it will be normalized.
Okay, Mr. Edison Bong Nebrija, thank you very much for joining us this morning, sir.